evening. It's so good to have you with us tonight. We want to begin our time of worship together singing Lamb of God. It's number 261 in your hymnal. Let's sing together. Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty sod and to become the Lamb of God. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. I was so lost, I should have died, but you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod, and to be called a Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood till I am just a Lamb of God.
Good evening, folks, and it's good to have you back with us tonight at Balfour Baptist Church, and so glad that you could join in with us tonight over our internet, and pray that the Lord will bless you and that the Holy Spirit would speak to us. As most of you know now, we're doing a series on Sunday evenings about spiritual warfare. Several years ago, I had the privilege of reading a book of the three spiritual battlegrounds, and so that's what we're doing, and I believe it's Francis Frangipane is the author of that book, and so we're actually on the fourth chapter tonight. Last week we looked at the beginning of Strongholds, and tonight we go a little bit deeper in that, Strongholds, spiritual strongholds, and the title of the message tonight is A House Made of Thoughts, Strongholds, and so that's where we want to go. Join with me if you would tonight as we ask God's blessings on what we do. Father, we thank you tonight for this privilege to be gathered together. Lord, we thank you for the privilege and honor to be in your word. I pray that God, the Holy Spirit, would speak to us. And God, I can't do this without your help. I need you to help me. And I ask that the Spirit of the living God would be with me, Father. Bless your word. And Lord, help us to leave this place saying it's been good to have been in the house of the Lord. And Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So tonight we want to look at strongholds again. Wherever there's a stronghold and where it exists, it is demonically induced. It's a pattern of thinking, that demonic thinking pattern that comes in. Specifically, it's a house made of thoughts, which has become a dwelling place for satanic activity. Now, the warning before deliverance is this. In Matthew chapter 12, beginning with verse 43 and looking at verse 44, it reads this in the New King James. It says, "Now when the unclean spirit goes out of a man, it passes through the waterless places seeking rest and does not find it. And then it says, I will return to my house from which I came. So that means in our lives that when we're dealing with strongholds and dealing with satanic influences, demonic of nature, that they will come back if we allow them to come back. Now we must realize, first of all, that a demon cannot dwell in a true Christian's life. That wherever the Spirit of God owns the heart, that a demon cannot reside there, but he can oppress and he can come against us. The Holy Spirit inside of us gives us discernment concerning the enemy's inroads. And so as we learned this morning, and as we looked at last Sunday night, we know that the inroads that Satan makes is through the carnal mind of our thought life, a house made of thoughts, if you would, of where our thought life invites and allows that enemy to come rushing back in. Now, the aspect of human nature most identifiably to the devil is carnal thought life. That's where the devil secretly invades our lives. And that's where those evil thoughts come into our lives. And it is in the uncrucified thoughts and the unsanctified thoughts and attitudes that unclean spirits find their way and have access into our hearts once again. In Matthew 12, again, 44 and 45, it reads this, "And when the unclean spirit comes, it finds its house unoccupied, swept, and put in order. Then it goes and takes along with it seven other spirits more wicked than itself. And they go in and live there, and the last state of that man becomes the worse than the first." So that we know that there are spiritual attacks of the enemy on our hearts and trying to destroy our relationship with God. To be successful in spiritual warfare, you must battle according to the Scripture. You must go with the power of God through the Word of God, and Christ must be brought in to deliver the soul. Now, I want you, if you would, to look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20. And the Word of God says this, as we get ready to look at this. It says, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of this world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again engaged therein and overcome, and the latter end is worse than them that at the beginning." So that we know that when it comes back. Now listen to, when you think about in spiritual warfare, we have to remove Satan's armor. In Luke 11, 21 and 22, it reads as follows. "And when the strong man, fully armed, guards his own homestead, his possessions are undisturbed. But when someone stronger than he attacks him and overpowers him, it takes away from him all the armor in which he had relied and distributes his plunder." Before salvation was undisturbed possession of the devil. Before we got saved and we had a relationship with Christ, it was an undisturbed place. It was an undisturbed possession of the enemy. Satan was like a fully armed strong man guarding his homestead. But when salvation came, when the power of the blood came and was accepted in our life, and the power of the Holy Spirit was poured into our life, then Jesus Christ attacked and overwhelmed the devil and stripped away his armor. His ability to control your life has been taken away. We have been made victors in Christ as long as we accept that in Him. In the spirit world, we would have observed the Holy Spirit working with the angels of God to destroy the enemy's frontline defense, his armor, as we have said. Now, what exactly is his armor? I want us to think about that. What was it keeping us from salvation? When you think about, we read in the scriptures that said many of the people that are in our world today, their eyes are blinded to the truth. That they have spiritual scales over their eyes where they're not able to see like some of us do. We know that their heart becomes hardened and it's not pliable and the Holy Spirit can't work in there. So we know that that's where Satan had most of us at one time in our life. And we think about that. But that armor that he has consisted of our thoughts, our attitudes, and our opinions that were in agreement with evil. That we were in agreement with what was wrong in this world. And folks, I'm telling you, in this world that we live in right now, there's a lot of people that are in agreement with evil. There's a lot of people that are in agreement with all that's wrong that's going on in this world right now. And so what Jesus described as armor, Paul called it a stronghold. And he says it's where we're seized up, we're bound up almost, chained almost to the wickedness of Satan as he attacks. Now, I want us, if we would tonight, if you would turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And we want to hear what God's word has to say. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, we want to read verses 1 through 4. Now I, Paul, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who is in the presence and abased among you, but being absent, I am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherein I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty through God in the pulling down of strongholds. Now it goes on to say, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. So it's about that avenue of the thoughts and the attitudes that Satan rides in to attack our lives and to try to defeat us. So are we to assume that all of our wrong ideas and attitudes have been eliminated with our salvation? Do we think that all of our battles and struggles have been counted over with because of salvation? And folks, salvation is a free gift of God that grants us eternal life. But then there comes sanctification and being fully filled with the Holy Spirit of God in order that God gives us the victory to walk in newness of life and in the power of the Holy Spirit. As I said this morning, all of us have a call on our life, and that is to be ye holy as I am holy. That is, if you'll remember, we went to about four or five different things where we went over things that are not to be a part of a Christian or a believer's life, that they're not to be named among us, because it said if you're involved in those things, then you won't have eternal life. And that's pretty plain. So we got to understand, we've got to be different. We've got to be not only saved by the power of God, but we've got to sanctify our hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit, and we've got to be filled with His presence. Now, strongholds still attempt to influence our perceptions and our behaviors. Old things are passed away, and truly all things become new. I agree with that, and that's what the Word of God says. But it won't be that way fully until we are walking in the fullness of Christ, when we should not assume the process of change is over. You know what that means? When I leave this filthy world, and God takes me and strips off the things of this life, and fully makes me in His image. I'm already made in His image, but I take on the fullness of Christ, and all this baggage of this world is washed away. Then I'll walk in the fullness with Him. So we must recognize what strongholds the Holy Spirit identifies for each of us. And we must agree with Him through repentance in the pulling of them down. That means today that if Keith or Barry or one of the ladies here, Gloria, if it's you or Bobby or me or whoever it might be, Brother Dwight, or whoever's listening today, if you have something in your life nobody else knows about, but God knows it's there, and obviously the enemy does. And he pours in through our thought patterns, our thinking of what we allow to come into our ears and eyes and what is rooted down into our heart. And he said it's with repentance that we begin to pull those things down. Now, strongholds don't refer to random thoughts or an occasional sin. Strongholds that affect us most are those thinking patterns that are hidden and we don't identify them as evil. There's something in the flesh nature that wants to gratify ourselves. We want to enjoy the flesh, but it's contrary to what God has called for, and it pulls us down. Now, when our thought life is in agreement with unbelief, with fear, and or habitual sin, the enemy is at rest because he's got you. He's got you defeated. Now, I'll agree that if you've truly been born again, that I believe that no man can take you out of his hand. And I believe that God's love is greater than we can ever imagine. But I also believe that what Satan's deal is, if he can't rob you of your salvation, then what he'll try to do is rob you of your relationship with God, in the effect that there's a wedge drove in there. And oftentimes I think about this. I think about the relationship that God has given me with my own son, that I will always love him. And I love him more than I can even imagine. He's my son. He has got my DNA inside of him, and I love him. But when he steps outside of where his daddy would have him to be, and if he violates our covenant agreement as father and son and what I expect of him, then he has sinned according to our relationship. He has violated me, and I'm going to be upset with him. There is a break in our relationship. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. When your child has violated something that you held dear with him and that you trusted him to do or she to do, and they violate that, then a wedge is drove in that relationship. That's exactly what Satan wants to do. If he can't drag you off to hell, then what he would like to do is drive a wedge in your relationship, keep you from being what God has called you to be, to keep you when you're burdened down and worried. And as we read that Paul said today, I'm a most miserable man, oh wretched man that I am. Folks, that's how we are sometimes. We're wretched, we're struggling, we literally feel like we're dying inside because we know that we're not where we're supposed to be. And God breaks our heart and tells us, you got a problem there. As I told you about that discipleship book that I read, My Heart, Christ Home, it says that we allow him to go into most rooms of our heart. We'll allow him to go to the living room or to the kitchen or to the bathroom. We'll allow him to come in and search. But there's a closet that many of us have that nobody else ever has access to. And in that room or in that closet, there's things that we think that God, we don't want him to see. But the problem is, God already knows what's there. He is that unseen eye. He is that ears at every conversation. And God knows what's holding your life back. And today what we're talking about is seeking with a remorseful heart repentance and allowing the power of God to break those things from our life. When our thought life is in agreement, as I said earlier, with unbelief and fear and habitual sin, the enemy is at rest. He's got you. He's got you out of whack. The process of deliverance often involves unrest, inner conflict, and turmoil, which is a good sign because it shows that the Holy Ghost is speaking to our heart and has got us very conflicted inside, got us troubled because we need to be. It's just like when I preach a gospel message. Folks, you got to understand, it's got to go through me before it gets to you. And oftentimes, the Holy Spirit will place a finger on my heart in a certain area of my life and tell me that this is an area that you've got to work on, or this deals with you in this part of your life. Now, we should expect a time when we must exercise our authority in Christ to resist the devil. If you think about 1 Peter 5:9, it tells us that if you resist the devil, he will flee from you. That means as a Christian, we've got to stand. Today I told all of you that in this world, we'll battle the world, we'll battle the flesh, and we battle the devil. And we know that in the world, we got to walk by faith. We've got to live in this world and yet not be a part of this world. And we have to live it by faith and walk it every day. When we deal with things of the flesh, things that try to get in our carnal way of life, try to revive that old man, the Bible tells us we got to flee from it. You got to run from the very presence of immorality. And then when we fight the devil, you got to dig your feet in, put on the whole armor of God, and stand and fight in Jesus' name. And that's what you've got to do to overcome it. And that's why Peter is saying that you've got to resist him and that he'll flee from you. Now, the devil will fight to remain in your life, and there'll be a period of infighting that will go on. But you got to take every thought captive to Christ. There's comfort in being a Christian today, to know that when we look at this image up here of Jesus and we think about what he did on Calvary, and that he took all of our sins and that he died on that cross and he shed his blood in order that we might be victorious today, And not only did he save us from the wickedness of our sins, he gave us the ability to live a sanctified life. And folks, there will be no excuse for any of us, starting with your preacher, that we are called to be sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. That means the power of God permeating through all of our life and radiating hopefully from our smile, our eyes, and all about our life. Being a Christian is far from being perfect. And we know that being saved and being born again and being a child of God, that every day is a battle. In the book of Luke, it tells us that we got to crucify the flesh every day. We've got to pick up that cross and we've got to follow him every single day. You must purpose to do that. And so there are many strongholds out there that's got to be pulled down. Many things in our life that we've got to allow the power of God to help us. I think about unbelief, cold love, fear, pride, grief, lust, unforgiveness, hatred, anger, bitterness. All those things can well up in your life and make strongholds there. Proverbs 23:7 says this, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." So folks, what's in your heart today? What's going on in your own personal life? Well, for deliverance from these strongholds, there's five things that I want to point out that they're just simple things. But we must recognize, honestly, our need. We must be willing to recognize, God, I need deliverance from this in my life. It is keeping me from being what you want me to be. Secondly, we must confess our need before him. We must repent. We must cry out to God and ask him for forgiveness. Thirdly, we must stop pretending everything's okay. You know, I can sit over here and one of my buddies, I'll pick Barry for instance, or Keith that's sitting here, but I can portray before them that everything's okay, that I'm happy and joyous and everything's good, when I know deep inside there is a war raging inside of me because I know that I am not where I'm supposed to be in Christ. So, folks, I ask you today to think about that. And I hope I haven't messed up walking away from the camera because sometimes I like to move around. But fourthly, we've got to be willing to drop our foolish pride and humble ourselves and recognize our dependence on God. And fifthly, we've got to seek help. And we do that on our knees crying out to God. So we got to recognize, confess, we got to stop pretending, got to humble ourselves, and we got to seek help. And those are the five just simple things that we've got to do. Now tonight, the first stronghold that must be removed is pride. Until we're willing to admit that we need deliverance, we will never be free from a stronghold. I remember one night not very long ago, a few months ago, there was a gentleman there who was talking to me and he said, "Well, I feel like I'm all right. I feel like I'm good. I attend church once in a while. I give my money and I believe that my relationship is intact." And as the conversation went on, he recognized for the first time that I don't have a personal relationship with him. And he began to think about it and tears began to pour and it came down. And that stronghold that had gripped his life, pride, he was willing to humble himself and recognize that I need to be delivered today from this foolish pride and humble myself and accept God. And he did that day. To recognize what is wrong in us, we must perceive God's standard of right. Hebrews 2:9 says, "We do see him, namely Jesus. He's what's right in our life. Jesus Christ is a model for the new creation of man." Now I want us, if you would, look over to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And look at verses 23 and 24. And it says, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind." All right? Now, again, we're talking about this computer up here. That's the place where everything we hear goes, everything we see goes, what we taste. It all goes to this brain, this computer, and eventually it travels, as somebody said the other day, 12 inches down to the heart, the center of man or woman's emotions. And it said, "Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. And notice that it said that you got to put it on. You got to be willing to want that and to strive for that in your life. Now, if you would, go back to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, and let's look at verses 28 and 29. Romans 8, 28 and 29. And it says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to His image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." Now, if you would, go with me to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. And it reads this, "For it became Him for whom all are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captive of their salvations perfect through sufferings." So as we yield to Jesus in increasing degrees of surrender, and as we abide in Him and His Word abides in us, He brings forth life that is not simply like His own, but is His very own life. Christ living within us fulfills God's eternal purpose. Folks, the bottom line is Jesus has got to shine within your life. That when I see one of my sisters or my brothers here today, or when I meet one of you or talk with you, Jesus must shine out of our life. And to understand that we're made in His image. It is this coming forth in us of the presence of the Lord that Jesus makes the weapons of our warfare mighty in God, empowering our words with authority as we pull down these strongholds. Then I think about any thought that fails to conform to Jesus. We must capture them, and wrong attitudes have to be crucified. And folks, that's an ongoing thing. There's many times that I've opened my mouth and the Holy Ghost has told me, shouldn't have said that, shouldn't have been there, or your attitude is not right on this. And I had to go back before God and ask God for His forgiveness and had to crucify those things. And that leads us to the second fortress that must be destroyed, and that is unbelief. And you might say, well, what do you mean about it being a fortress for the enemy where we're chained up, a stronghold? The scheme of thinking Christ-likeness, many of you might say, it's impossible. There is no way that I can ever be like Him, which holds our spiritual growth hostage. And I tell you today that being able to be Christ-like is possible. The devil will tell you that it's impossible. This lie that Satan will say that you can't do it places chains on your heart and must be broken and stripped away, because the Word of God says that you're to be holy as He is. You're to strive to be Christ-like. You're not to be like the preacher. You're not to be like the best woman or man that you know. You're supposed to be like Jesus. Now, the other defeat of a stronghold would be this: failure. It's important to remember that a stronghold is a house made of thoughts. And Paul said that our success in spiritual warfare over strongholds is based on that passage found in 2 Corinthians 10:5. Every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. That means that you've got to capture everything that has to be in obedience to Him. You can't let yourself slide. Man, we can't sit at a table and talk about filthy things and expect for God to be glorified. We can't sit there and carry on conversations about things below and expect to make an impact on somebody's life for the kingdom of God. So repentance today means to change, and it don't mean just remorse. I'm a failure. I'm just a sinner. I'll always be a failure. I'm tired. I'm ready to give up. I'm tired of walking in the Spirit. I'm ready to quit. I don't know why God hadn't heard me. God doesn't love me anymore. All of this rubbish is lies of Satan. And God tells you and reminds you that he gave his very best, that when Jesus died on that cross, he died for all of our sins, a multitude of filthiness. As I said this morning, there is none righteous, no, not one. The heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? And yet the power of his blood flowed over our lives, and that the Spirit of God knocked on our heart. Revelation 3:20 says that he stands at the door and knocks. And I realize that that verse of scripture is about where Christ is trying to knock on the door of the church to get in. Because no longer is the gospel being preached like it should be. But folks, it can also be applied to our individual life. He says, behold, I stand at your door of your heart and I knock. And I'll come in if you will allow me to come in, and I'll dine with you and you with me if you'll just let me in. So folks, we've got to understand today, we can be changed. We can surrender to him. We've got to capture the thought that I'm a failure. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And that means we can be godly. We can be holy. Folks, I don't know about you, but I want to be the kind of man that can walk in a door right there. And when I walk in there, that people can sense the presence of God on my life. Not from a personal pride deal, but to know that the power of God resides in my life and comes out through my voice and in my lifestyle. We've got to arrest the thought that I'm just a sinner. I've heard so many people say that. I'm just a sinner that was saved by grace. God knows that I'm a flesh and I'm prone to fail. Even Paul over there in Romans 7 talked about how he had struggles. There is no excuse. And we've got to understand that the blood cleanses all sin. 1 John 1:9 says that when we find a sin in our life and we know that we fell short, we're to fall to our knees, cry out to God, and confess our sins. And the Bible says he is faithful and just to cleanse us and forgive us of all unrighteousness. Amen? And we've got to learn to rely on that. Let it be established in your attitudes that the goal and the purpose of your life is to be conformed to the image of Christ. Not Billy Graham, not Charles Stanley, not David Jeremiah. They're all great men. Not some preacher at another church, not the preacher at Balfour, but to Jesus Christ. That's who you're to be conformed to. And as long as we recognize that our salvation is a continued transformation and that we are changing from glory to glory in the image of Christ, we should not be discouraged by the strongholds that we discover in our life. We just have to deal with them. Setbacks and failures we experience will not stop us. For the giant has been exposed and is only a matter of time before it's removed. Folks, I'm here to tell you that in your life, as the Holy Ghost begins to look at your life and you take evaluation, you're going to find some things sometimes that trouble you. It may be your way of thinking, your pattern of thought. It may be something that you do in the quietness of nobody else being around, but God knows. And when God puts his finger on your life, it may be anger or hatred towards somebody that has done you wrong. It may be a bitter feeling that has come in and has resided there for years of how they treated you. But yet God says that is a habitual sin that's got to be taken from your life and you got to be filled with the love of God. And your mind can go anywhere right now, and those things can be strongholds in your life. And you've got to allow God to tear them down. Then I think about the stronghold of fear. 1 John 4:8 says, there is no fear in love, for love casts out all fear. Victory begins in the name of Jesus. With it on our lips, knowing that we go forth in the name of Jesus, but it's not consummated until the nature of Jesus is in our hearts. So victory begins by calling on his name. It begins by dropping to our knees and crying out to God. And it's not consummated until the nature of Christ lives with inside of us. It's not enough to have your house swept and put in order, as we read a while ago in Matthew 12:44. Your thought life must be occupied by the person and the power of Christ. I'm telling you, in this world that we live, I think about this little thing that I have in my pocket right here. It can be used for such wonderful things. I started to walk out here, and I'm afraid I'd walk outside the camera, so I'll stay right here. It can be used for such wonderful things. The computer, the television, the movie screens at movie theaters that we haven't got to see in quite a while. But all these things are wonderful inventions, and yet it gives us direct access to filth if we so choose. Degraded filth, straight from the pits of hell. And there's been more men and more women that have been destroyed because of the filth that is transmitted over these little things in our computers than I can even begin to express to you. Lives that have been shattered and relationships that have been broken and people have been drawn away from God because of the power of the flesh. So victory begins with Jesus on our lips. And we know that He's got to be in our heart. And we do have to keep our house swept. But we've got to guard our heart and occupy every area of our life through the power of Christ. And I want you to understand today that the weapons that you have at your disposal are mighty in God for pulling down these strongholds. Folks, tonight as we come together and as we think about strongholds in our life, I think this hits all of us at our point where we live our life. I think that when we think about those deep and dark things that may be in our life, areas of weakness, areas that we have not confessed before God and allow Him to take lordship. There's some of you that have problems with things that other people don't have a problem with that. I've got some friends that have a problem with controlling their tongue. And they say things that destroy their testimony. And yet, they don't have the same problem that another man will have by looking at visual images on a movie or on a phone or on some website. Folks, I heard a man tell me one time, he said if we could get an image of some men, he said if we could get an image of the women that you see on some kind of website or some image that you see on the camera, if you could tear away the facade that's there and you'd see the horribleness of hell, of Satan himself, as he laughs, as he destroys your relationship with God. Folks, we must understand, whether it be fear, whether it be unbelief, whether it be pride, whether it be anger, whether it be a bitter spirit. I just listed off some things, whether it be greed, whether it be some type of lust, maybe an unforgiving attitude where you just cannot forgive somebody. Maybe it's cold love. I talked to a man just 2 days ago who told me that his wife has not told him he loved him in over 30 years. As a matter of fact, he said, I don't know that I've ever heard her tell me that. And he said, it's cold love. She is bound up with that in his life, and now it has done damage in his own life. Folks, we have to understand that all these things are strongholds that destroy our relationship with God and keep us from being what God would have us to be. Folks, we're living right now in a world where people are dying and going to hell. We're living in a world right now where people are living life to their fullest of what they think, and they're on a roaring rampage to hell. And it's time for us as the church to wake up. It's time for us to realize that our opportunity to work is slowly passing away. And we must be out there making an impact in our world. And folks, for us to be effective for the cause of Christ is that we have to crucify the flesh. And we have to allow God to reign full and supreme. We have to allow God to fill us with the power of the Holy Ghost. You know, one of the best feelings that I ever have when I stand in this pulpit is when I can sense the power of the Holy Spirit working in my life. When I can sense Him all over my back of my head, on top of my head, on my arms. I remember one time I was sitting back there in that seat right there many months ago. And I was sitting there and I was over there and I said, Lord, I'm waiting to feel you this morning. I just hadn't felt you yet. There's nothing like, once you feel the presence of God, you know what it is. When you feel the anointing of God, when His Holy Spirit comes on you. And I remember sitting there, and all of a sudden it was like almost a thickness like honey that fell over my head, and I could feel the presence of God come over me. And that day I preached with power and conviction because the anointing of the Holy Ghost fell on me as I stood here at this sacred desk. Folks, in order for that to fall on our lives on a regular basis, we got to be clean. We got to be pure. And we got to walk victorious. So I challenge you today. Allow God to take this house made of thoughts and take it captive and break those chains and take every thought captive to the Lord and allow Him to help us to be godly and holy. Folks, I pray that you receive what I've said tonight. Again, this is a study that I had the privilege of studying long ago. And no, it didn't come from Baptist circles. It came from the family of God. It came with the anointing of God that helps us in our spiritual warfare. You know, I said a long time ago, you know, me being a policeman, and I know Barry Bunning is here. Barry has been a policeman, but there was a time when we would wrestle the enemy and they would put handcuffs on him. We'd arrest him and carry him to jail. We'd have him charged or whatever it is. But folks, the Bible tells us now that our enemy is not flesh and blood. The Bible tells us that our enemy is one that we can't see. I want you to listen to this, and I had no intentions of reading this again today, but I feel like I ought to. It says, finally, my brethren, in chapter 6 of the book of Ephesians, verse 10, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. This is what we've got to hold on to. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. I had a man tell me one time that if God would take the scales from our eyes and allow us to see what is there in the heavenlies that is going on, we'd be terrified of the enemy that works to destroy our lives. But God has got His angels working for us in doing spiritual battle if we'll just trust Him. It says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, and that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, stand. Ladies, that means digging your feet in and saying, I shall not be moved. Men, it means digging your hooves in and saying, Lord, I stand for you. And Lord, I pick up the full armor of God. And Lord, I go with Jesus on my lips. And I make it in Jesus' name. So folks, tonight, I ask you to join me in prayer as we pray. And I pray that if the Lord has spoke to your heart, if there's something in your life that nobody else knows. Maybe God has revealed something tonight. Maybe you deal with anger. Maybe you deal with profanity. Maybe you're dealing with something sexual of nature. Maybe there's unfaithfulness in your relationship. Maybe there's unfaithfulness to God. Maybe you've violated covenants and you've got all kinds of things going on. Folks, won't you come back to Him? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man would open the door, I will come in to him and sup with him and he with me. Tonight, won't you run to Him? Won't you trust Him? And may you allow the power of God to move in your life. Father, I thank you for this night. I pray, oh God, that, Lord, I feel like my efforts are so weak and feeble. And yet, Lord, there's power in your word and power in the Holy Ghost. And God, I ask that, Lord, you would allow this message to take root in fertile soil. Lord, I pray that you would draw all of us, starting with me, Lord, to be victorious in our everyday walk. And Lord, that we would walk in obedience to you in everything that we do. Tonight, if there's one out there, Lord, that is struggling. Tonight, if there's one out there that has never really known the Lord. Then God, I pray that the power of God would speak to their heart. And Lord, I pray that you would draw them. That they would seek that salvation. That they would ask you for forgiveness of sin. and they would ask you to come into their life. And for all of us that are Christians that have called on the name of the Lord, and yet we find ourselves sometimes struggling, not doing what we know that we're supposed to do, but we do the things sometimes that we know that we're not supposed to. God, break those things in our life. And help us, oh God, to be strengthened and empowered through the power of God. God, we can't make it without you. We need your help. And we ask you to come, Lord, and be with us. Give us grace and strength today. And help us to humble ourselves to say, God, I can't handle this on my own. I need your help. And I ask you to bless me, Lord, and ask you to help me. Father, hear our prayers today. Bless this church and bless everyone that listened tonight. God, may you make this a blessing to their lives. And God, may you teach us, oh Lord, about trusting in you in these days of wickedness and evil. Help us, Lord, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Just wanted to say thank you today for watching our service, our broadcast. I've done the best that I can today to preach the Word of God and to be able to share with you in a powerful way. And I just wanted to make sure that you understand that if you have any type of need that we can help you, any prayer concern that we can do, please contact us and let us know, because we want to be a blessing to you. It's about the kingdom of heaven, and it's about you, and it's about being able to meet your needs. And so we just want to thank you today for choosing to come on our broadcast and to listen to what we have to say. And I just pray that God's been blessed and lifted up and honored. If you have a desire today to give to our ministry, and I can assure you that every dime that we ever receive will go to the full gospel ministry of getting the Word of God out to other people. So just hit the giving tab that's there on our webpage, and all that will just kind of guide you through it. So I just want you to know today that we're grateful to have you. And this is a tremendous part of our ministry right now that is going over the internet, people coming to our website. We're excited about what God's doing. We're excited about what He's going to do through this effort here. And so anyway, I just want you to know that we want to be a blessing to you. Please join us again. And we look forward to that.